Cheer up, parents. School starts in just 12 weeks. I'm Charlie Sykes. Sunday Insight starts right now. Good morning and welcome to Sunday Insight. In the week that was boxing great, Muhammad Ali is laid to rest. Aaron Rodgers rocks our world by announcing that he's giving up eating dairy here in the Dairyland. Weak job numbers raise more questions about the health of the economy. Hillary Clinton clinches the Democratic nomination, gets President Obama's endorsement, and is headed here to Wisconsin for their first joint appearance. But we're going to start again with the GOP. The bromance between House Speaker Paul Ryan and Donald Trump was always complicated. But it got even more tangled this week when Ryan denounced Trump's comments about the Mexican heritage of a federal judge. That judge is presiding over a Trump University fraud case. He was born in Indiana. But Trump suggested that the fact that he was Latino might make him biased against the GOP's presumptive nominee. Ryan called that a textbook case of a racist comment.
Claiming a person can't do their job because of their race is sort of like the textbook definition of a racist comment. I think that should be absolutely disavowed. It's absolutely unacceptable. But do I believe that Hillary Clinton is the answer? No, I do not.
Yeah, so there you have it. Ryan says it's unacceptable, but he still accepts Trump as a candidate for president. Meanwhile, Governor Scott Walker also disavowed the comments, but hedged his support for Trump going forward.
Right now, I'm just focused on encouraging him and others who support him in his inner circle to make it clear that there's a lot of us expect, not as Republicans, but as Americans, that if you want to be viewed as a credible candidate, you need to make it clear that you don't associate with those beliefs.
Joining me on our panel this morning, the Milwaukee Community Journal's Michael Holt, former Republican State Representative Michelle Litchens, defense attorney Dan Adams, and the president of Edge Messaging, Brian Fraley. All right, Brian, Paul Ryan is trying to walk a tightrope, denouncing Donald Trump but still supporting him. How is he doing? How is he doing on that tightrope?
He's not doing very well, but I don't know that he could do very well. You have three options with Donald Trump, right? You embrace him, like the RNC staff has had to do. You reject him, like you have, like I have, and many others. Or you kind of just accept him, but then criticize him. And that's what Paul Ryan's going to have to do from now until Trump fades from the scene.
Yeah, but he's being beaten up now by both the left and the right, you know, to say, yes, it's a racist comment, but winning this election apparently is so important that we're willing to embrace that?
I mean,
it is a little cognitive dissonance.
There's that. It's also death by a thousand cuts or death by a thousand tweets, as it were. And you wonder, at some point, are they just going to say, to heck with qualifying, excusing, being outraged at the statement but not the man, and just say to heck with Donald Trump? It seems to me that you would do it sooner rather than later, but I actually think that Paul Ryan, and you guys have poo-pooed this, is scared about his seat. I think he's scared that this Paul Nyland, who's a Trumpite, is going to come in and have Trump come in to Janesville and rally for him.
I think that's wrong. I think that the key thing is that he's concerned about his majority, that as Speaker. I think that if it was Congressman Paul Ryan, or even if it was Paul Ryan who was the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, he would be saying something completely different, but he's got a different responsibility. But leaving aside whether the comments were racist or not, the fact that Donald Trump, I think, showed his fellow Republicans that he is not disciplined, that he's not prepared to change his tone, that in the last 5 weeks he had a chance to get a little bit of a head start. He's not talking about Hillary's emails. He's not talking about the lousy jobs numbers. He's talking about a Trump University fraud case that wasn't in the news except that he decided to inject it.
I think a lot of people assumed once he was the nominee that he was going to start, acting more presidential. In fact, he promised people he would start acting more presidential, and he is not doing that at all. But I think this is giving us an opportunity to do, and I know that you are. Yeah. You don't believe this is going to happen at all. Right. But if he continues to sound like the buffoon that he is purporting or showing himself to be, and if enough people who were supporting him early on say, you know what, we can't have this guy as our nominee, we could see something happen.
I think over the next 2-3 weeks, if he cleans up his act, he's going to get the nomination. On the other hand, we're always one tweet away from the implosion, one slur away. If in fact Hillary gets a big bump and he is down by 12 points or so, almost anything could happen at this convention. What do you think, Michael Holt?
Oh, I mean, you better get used to it because he is going to be the nominee. I don't see any way around it. If I were Donald Trump, what I would do is get my PR guy to find a third person to question whether or not he is he made a racist remark? Or was he just being prejudiced? I mean, you have to look at what he actually said.
Yeah.
He said all these inflammatory things about Latino. You know, he's pointed them out in the past. He's made some prejudicial statements about them. And so to imply that this guy, who happens to be Hispanic, would rule against him because of those remarks is based on prejudice.
Yeah.
Is that racist?
Well, I don't get it. What
your distinction is.
Charlie, he had a taco salad, so why should he worry about it, right? He said that Hispanics love him, so everything's fine.
See, Donald Trump is being honest about one thing. You know, he said it in a press conference. No. When he said, I am not going to change.
Right.
You know, this man is not going to change. Anyone who thinks that he's going to change, that is the triumph of hope over experience. He is what he is. And I have said this to the Republicans. You own this. And I think that there has been this sort of a coalition of the deluded people saying, okay, you know, because he told us in a private meeting he's going to change. He is not. And this is part of the problem for all of the down ballot Republicans, that they are going to own this. And I think, look, Paul Ryan is the most talented politician of his generation. And the fact that he is not able to finesse this, he is not able basically to thread the needle, ought to be a warning to all of these other candidates around the country. So what is your glass half full? What is your glass half empty this week? Let's go around the table. Michael Holt, you are first.
Well, my glass is half full because House Speaker Paul Ryan, as I said, stepped out of his comfort zone and blasted Donald Trump for a racist comment. My glass is half empty because in the next breath, Ryan said he still supports Trump because, quote, he's the best hope for getting a GOP agenda enacted. Excuse me, what's that agenda? Trump-style apartheid?
Michelle Litchens.
My glass is half full because fewer high school students are sexually active than they were 10 years ago. It's half empty because sexually hooking up is the norm in college and kids don't know what a relationship is anymore.
Dan Adams.
Well, my glass is half full because Stanford University did the right thing and called the police to respond to a sexual assault last year rather than have campus bureaucrats deal with the serious offense. The assailant, Brock Turner, was properly investigated and convicted by the American justice system. My glass is half empty because Turner was only given a 6-month sentence. This was astoundingly lenient given his terrible conduct.
Brian Fraley.
Amen on that, Dan. Hey, my glass is half full because summer is almost here. My glass is half empty because I still haven't finished my spring cleaning to-do list. Sorry, honey, I'll get to it, I promise.
Oh, yeah. Well, my glass is half full because Hillary Clinton did make history this week as the first woman to win her party's nomination for president. It's half empty because Hillary Clinton also made history for being the first presidential nominee to be under an active criminal investigation by the FBI. Fun times. Our Sunday Inside Countdown shows that we are just 2 days away from the end of the primary season. The District of Columbia votes on Tuesday. Hillary Clinton and President Obama campaigned together in Green Bay in 3 days from today. The Republican National Convention in Cleveland is 36 days away. The Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia is 43 days away. The presidential election, Tuesday, November 8th, is 149 days from today. We will be right back.
Thanks to you, we've reached a milestone. First time in our nation's history that a woman will be a major party's nominee.
Well, Hillary Clinton sealed the deal. Her primary wins last week, coupled with overwhelming support from so-called superdelegates, effectively clinched the nomination, and Democrats were quick to coalesce around her.
So I want those of you who've been with me from the beginning of this incredible journey to be the first to know that I'm with her.
I am fired up. President Obama released that endorsement video, and the two will make their first campaign stop together in Green Bay this week. But it has been a surprisingly hard slog and a brutal primary fight, raising the question, how hard will it be to pull Bernie Sanders supporters back into the fold? Michael Holt, you were feeling the burn for a while. You're ready to be.
I voted for Bernie. I'm not.
Yeah, I know. You don't have to be defensive about it. I'm just saying, how hard is it going to be for you guys to unite around Hillary?
Well, number one, we have no choice.
Yeah.
Number two, I would like to be on this train ride to history. And she would be the first woman. I guess she'll be on the $50 bill or something in the future. And she'll probably win this race, particularly if Donald Trump keeps talking and making all these asinine statements. You know, as for Bernie, you know, I really envisioned him taking this all the way to the convention. Because, you know, Bernie was able to get Hillary to start addressing issues that she didn't want to address, like poverty, the criminal justice system, etc. He's an important figure in reconstructing the Democratic platform.
But how long do you think he stays in this race, Dan Adams?
Oh, it doesn't matter at this point. Yeah. He'll go to the convention. He'll have a primetime speaker spot. He successfully...
You don't think he's going to drop out before the convention?
I don't really think it matters at this point. I mean, President Obama endorsed
him. They moved on. I mean,
We've all moved on, and she had a really good week this week. I mean, she took on Trump in a way that Jeb, Scott Walker, Rubio all tried to do, kind of fell flat. She did it successfully. She had a really nice kind of acceptance speech of the nomination this week.
And okay, do Democrats come together? Now, I mean, at the end of a lot of these primaries, people are going, well, it's going to be a really hard time. I mean, you know, there was a tough fight between Obama and Hillary 8 years ago, and eventually all the Hillary supporters fell in behind Barack Obama. Will the Bernie Sanders supporters fall in?
Some of them will.
They already are.
No, I don't think. No. If I were to guess right now, I would say a majority of them wouldn't, because they look at Hillary Clinton as the establishment.
Well, she is the establishment.
Well, they went to Bernie because he was offering something new and fresh. I don't think they're going to just fall over for
it. I think most Democrats are going to coalesce around Hillary Clinton, because the Democrats always do, because they want to win. Now there's going to be a segment.
Will she be able to get the kind of turnout that Barack? I mean, Barack Obama just nailed it.
No, because there is absolutely no enthusiasm out there. In fact, the Democrats that are currently supporting her already said, "Well, we really don't trust her, but we're going to support her anyway."
She won't need the turnout, because turnout's going to be depressed because of Donald Trump. Look, one thing the Democrats do so much better than the Republicans, and they have an easier path doing it this year. Look where they're going, their very first joint appearance. Mm-hmm. Wisconsin's 8th congressional district, with an open congressional seat, going to be very competitive, and a U.S. Senate seat here. They are strategic. Yeah. Donald Trump doesn't give a damn about down-ticket Republicans.
Yeah, see, I don't think that Democrats are enthusiastic about Hillary Clinton. On the other hand, maybe they don't have to be, because I think the Democrats are going to be motivated by Donald Trump to turn out, and he basically puts together the Obama coalition. So you might not want to hear it, but we will tell you anyway. Let's hand out some unsolicited advice, and Michael Holt, you are first.
Well, speaking for angry aldermen, Police Chief Ed Flynn refused to apologize for his insulting and insensitive four rules to avoid being murdered comment. Hey, Chief, if you want to rebuild community relations, a simple apology goes a long way.
Michelle Litchens.
Well, my advice is for District Attorney John Chisholm. Yes, community outreach is needed to prevent crime, but today you need to put the criminals in jail.
Dan Adams.
Well, for parents, America's opiate epidemic doesn't discriminate. Yes, it's affecting your kid's school. Two things you can do: search your cabinets for old Percocets, Vicodin, OxyContin. Throw them out. Second, start the conversation about the danger of these drugs.
Brian Fraley.
Indeed. Look, if you're sick of the condition of Wisconsin roads, do something about it. Join an effort I'm working on. Go to justfixitwi.com and share your story. We want to hear from you.
Okay, so my advice is for Republicans like Paul Ryan. I know you think you can walk a tightrope with Donald Trump disavowing comments that are racist, un-American, and unacceptable. But then you say you would accept him as president. My advice, this is not going to end well, and the sooner you realize it, the better. Next on Sunday Insight, Aaron Rodgers passes on dairy. This is Wisconsin. So we talk about the Green Bay Packers and cheese. We do. Last week, Packers quarterback Aaron Rodgers said that he was cutting out dairy from his diet. That means no milk, cheddar, provolone, Gouda, or Monterey Jack. The 32-year-old Rodgers said that he wanted to get healthier and extend his playing career, which is fine. So he's adopting what he calls more of a vegan diet, with some red meat and at times and some chicken. Also more fruits and vegetables, mostly vegetables, he said. But no dairy, which is tricky since, well, we're cheese heads here, Michelle Litchens.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care what Aaron Rodgers eats or what he does, but I don't know. There's kind of a PR issue here.
I'm very disappointed. Yeah. I understand if he was asked the question, he had to answer it and say what he was doing. He really could have said, but I'm going to miss the cheese. Yeah. You know, we've got great cheese custard. We are a dairy state. He represents the Dairy State, you know, as our quarterback. And so I'm disappointed that he said it. I understand what he's doing, but I'm still kind of
Now, you know what? At least half of our listeners think this is goofy that we're talking about this. This is one of the major industries in the state. We are cheeseheads. And, you know, quite frankly, this is the most famous, you know, potentially, you know, culturally influential. I mean, this is a
problem. Well, but in related news, Jay Cutler is down to 2 packs a day. So, so long as Brett Favre is still eating venison jerky, I think we're going to be fine. Listen,
Because these quarterbacks are not going to be giving up supermodels and actresses and stuff like that. Listen, so what? It's got to be cheese.
I don't care what he does as long as he gets us into the playoffs and beats the Bears.
Okay. Well, that's fair enough.
Being painfully self-aware, I'm the last person on this panel to give anybody health advice. But my friends who are dairy farmers will tell you that the myth of dairy being unhealthy and cheese being unhealthy is prevalent and should be busted. It's not a healthier diet to give up dairy at all.
Okay, so is it too soon to blame Olivia Munn for this? Is this an Olivia Munn thing? Is this California?
Yeah, I'm sure he get it from her. You know, I mean, but the reality is he's lost 12 pounds.
Yeah.
And he's talking about extending his career.
Right.
You know. And this comes out the same day as the feds announce that 57% of black women are obese.
Okay.
So, hey.
Connect the dots.
I don't know. I just have to get that out there. I'm waiting all week to get that out.
Well, look. I mean, I understand that the abuse of any food is unhealthy, but dairy products are not unhealthy. And in terms of calcium.
I don't know.
What do you mean?
No. It's everything is okay.
Everything
in moderation is good for you. I mean, cheese is so yummy. They serve it as desserts in some countries, you know? So I think anything in moderation is fine. Cheese is good for you in moderation. And again, I'm just sad that our star quarterback had to say it out loud.
Okay, you know what? I just would love to be a fly on the wall in the Packer PR department when he said, what, really? Okay, this is, you know. Hey, Sir Geno is on the line. So what is it you don't get? Let's go around the table. Michael Holt, you're first.
In case y'all didn't get it the first segment. Was Donald Trump's comments about a Mexican-American judge racist or presidential? Yeah. Ask a black person with a speeding ticket if he would rather have a white judge or a black one. Would their answer be racist?
Michelle Litchens.
That's a good question. Charlie, I don't get how the right of the people to keep and bear arms in the Constitution doesn't give people the right to carry a concealed weapon in California.
Dan Adams.
I don't get how there is bipartisan consensus that our state roads and bridges need work, yet Governor Walker's admin has submitted a no revenue increase proposal for the next transportation budget. Folks, we need a serious mixed revenue plan.
Brian Fraley.
Charlie, what I don't get is I've been told that Trump is expanding the Republican Party. But where are the Trumpkins? Not at county party headquarters, not manning the phones, not sending in donations.
Well, last week, Milwaukee County decided to start telling police when juvenile offenders violate GPS monitoring overnight. Apparently, Milwaukee County had been waiting until 8 a.m. the next morning to tell cops, and by then the juveniles who were supposed to be under supervision had already gone on crime sprees. What I don't get is, what took them so long? Next on Sunday Insight, our panel picks the winners and losers of the week, but first, here's the morning news update. It's time for our panel to pick the winners and losers of the week. Michael Holt, you are first.
Well, my loser are the constituents of State Representative Janelle Branchin, who said last week she would try to reduce shared revenues to Milwaukee unless the mayor can stop crime from spilling into the suburbs. Apparently, she wants to be on Donald Trump's short list for VP. My winner, Hillary Clinton, unless there's divine intervention, she will soon be the first woman to head a major party presidential ticket.
Michelle Litchens.
The winners this week are the high school students from DSHA and Marquette who helped to better the lives of people in Ecuador the last 2 weeks. I bet they're more likely to appreciate living in the United States when they come home. The losers are the people who were selling tickets to Muhammad Ali's funeral last week. The tickets were free. Charging for a funeral, that just isn't right.
Dan Adams.
My winner, State Senator Lena Taylor, for bringing much needed attention to Milwaukee's drinking water and questioning whether it contains too much lead. This could be a big issue. Thank you, Senator Taylor. My loser is Republican State Representative Brenchen, who sent a finger-pointing, nasty diatribe blaming Milwaukee for suburban crime. Representative Brenchen, real leaders work on public policy issues. They don't just complain about them. That's counterproductive.
Brian Fraley.
Hey, my losers are the administrators at the Verona School District who refuse to let Noah Currier walk in graduation. Noah suffers from a rare immunization disorder, which caused him to miss a lot of school, and he's a half credit short, won't have enough credits until next month. Rather than being understanding, the losers at Verona schools are being pinheads. The winners are all the high school grads across Wisconsin, like my cousin's son, Nick Bath. Congratulations, and keep making your families proud.
Well, loser Republicans think that Donald Trump is going to change. Look, if the fate of your political party rests on getting a 70-year-old man to act like an adult, you are in for a very tough year. My winner, we don't get a lot of good news about the state of our culture, but last week we got a new study that said that fewer teenagers are having sex, doing drugs, drinking, or smoking. Kids these days. Thanks for joining us today for my radio show Monday morning on News Radio 620 WTMJ from 8:30 until noon. Have a great week.